Well, dear friends, we look at today what is perhaps the alpha and omega of the gospel message. It's Genesis, its source, its end. We now look at that part of the gospel so cleanly spoken by John the Apostle that is at the very core of our salvation. This is the gospel proper in some ways. I've entitled this amazing text in 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 14 as that we might live through him. That phrase, which is a direct quote of one of John's clauses in this marvelous paragraph, is the entirety of the logic of the gospel. God loved us so much that he gave his son that we might live through him. Now, I can remember a Bible club, and we used to sing one of Dottie Rambo's songs. Of course, we funked it up really, really, really tough. Where do I go when there's nobody else to turn to? Who do I talk to when nobody wants to listen? Who do I lean on when there's no foundation stable? And then the answer, I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock. That's the first stanza, first verse of this marvelous song. This is the essence of our religion, its dependence on God. It started with God rescuing us. Here's a group of people who were saved on the Mediterranean by a boat that saved them. They were in a craft and they were rescued. They were trying to get to some help and they were saved. They were delivered. We are accustomed to the ideas of deliverance. There are whole occupations devoted to deliverance. There is an entire division of our armed services, the Coast Guard, that is known specifically for its ability to deliver. All they do is wait for opportunities to deliver. Their deliverance, their job is rescue. It's an amazing thing. They will go and we know of lifeguards who go and grab people when they're in jeopardy. Here's a picture of a dear guy who fell in a hole. And this is at the end of a long extraction. They went in and got him out of this hole that he was in. And he lived through their rescue. The rest of his life is dependent on them delivering him and him acknowledging that. Quite literally, what a picture of the Bible. For there's one God and one mediator between God and men, God and humankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Dear friends, that's who Jesus is, this portrait of our Lord saving Peter walking on the water. The most ubiquitous, everywhere present phrase regarding our Lord is Savior. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order to save the world, that the world might be saved through him. That's John 3:16. So here is the theme of this teaching. Here is the gospel, friends. God loved the world so much that he sent his only son into it in order to save it, so that we who live might live through him. We who believe might come to live forever because of him. Now, 1 John 4, 7 through 14 is an amazing text. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. There's the phrase that I borrowed my title from. In this is love, not that we loved God. This is what a text. But that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation, the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. What a text. The clearest statement of the gospel, one of them in the entire Bible. So we'll look at the facts here, try to interpret the meaning of those, look at a few of the gospel implications that emerge, and then focus on how we make this our own. How do we actualize this? To begin with, what do we see here? Well, you see up front our love for God. We prove our love for God by the love that we have one another. That's the clear thing. Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. Our love for God is proven through our love for each other. And second, God's love for us is seen here. God proved his love for us by sending his Son into the world as a propitiation, as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. Love is not that we love God. It's that he loved us and sent his Son, who obeyed his command and came into the world and offered himself as a sacrifice for our sin. This is the essence of the gospel. This is eternal life. This is why I will not die, is that I believe in, I cling to, I hope upon that one simple message, that God proved his love for all humankind by sending his Son into the world as a sacrifice. And then John gives us the only logical conclusion that we can draw. If God so loved us, we ought then to love one another. Guys, if God loved us in this way, John's logic is, then we ought to love one another. Surely, if God loves you, you can return that favor to those who also believe in him. John said that we know that we are in God, that he is in us, by his Spirit that he has given to us. We abide in him because he has given to us of his Holy Spirit. And then John summarizes this amazing, remarkable text by saying that by this we see and we testify. Here's the testimony. The Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. This is it. We live through him. Now, guys, we know this, right? John 3:16-17, for God loved the world so much, this mini Bible, this great text. God loved the world so much. He so loved it that he gave his only Son. These are Jesus's words, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God sent his Son into the world to save it, that we might live through him. The same thing is said in John 6, verses 54 through 57. Whoever feeds on my flesh, Jesus said, and drinks my blood has eternal life. Wow. And I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. In verse 57, as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he, she also will live because of me. We live through him. Now, how do we interpret this? The gospel, this is the way I would summarize this text. The gospel boldly declares that God sent his one and only son into the world that we who believe might receive eternal life through him. Guys, this, again, is the essence of the gospel, right? It'll never change. This will always be the same. This is what the gospel declares. This unchanging good news. I like what Spurgeon said. He said, look, though you've changed 1,000 times, God has not changed even once. His rescue is real. He will never, ever turn his back on the one whom he has delivered. This is the ground of our faith. This is why we are Christian. This is what it means to be a believer, to be in the church, to have the hope of heaven, to know God in the kingdom. He's never changed his message. He sent his son into the world that we might live through him. And what are the implications of this? Well, there are three. We should love others because God loved us. God proved his love for us by sending his son. And the Father sent his son into the world to save us, that we might live through him. Guys, this is as simple, as basic, as clear as it can possibly be. And how then do we acknowledge this? How do we actualize this? How do I make this my own so it can transform my life? I have to let myself be rescued. I have to receive this love. Guys, I think this is the great problem of humankind, is that even though the Father sent his son into the world to save it, there are very few people who will let themselves be rescued. I like what this one sister wrote in a book. I think it's absolutely true. I'm absolutely convinced, Ms. DeMuth said, that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you receive God's love in this way? Is this the way you relate to God, that nothing can get between you and his love because he sent his son and now you live through him? In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only son into the world so that we might live through him. Guys, we love because he first loved us. I like what C.S. Lewis said on this. The Christian doesn't think God will love us because we are good, but that God will make us good because he loves us. Just as the roof of a sun house does not attract the sun because it is bright, but becomes bright because the sun shines on it. Look, you can tell people upon whom the love of God is shining. Do you know this love? I mean, honestly, in your heart. Are you being transformed by this love? I know many believers who know the facts about this, but they never received God's love. Here's the gospel. God loved the world so much that he sent his only son into it in order to save it so that we who believe might live through him. Here's a final thing. I want to challenge you guys to receive the divine love today. Kristen Rieck says, when we come to an understanding of how much God loves us, we'll be able to truly trust him no matter what circumstances come our way. Receive his divine love today and release the need to control every situation. His peace will cover you. Guys, all God has ever wanted to do is to rescue you. That's it. Helpless, vulnerable, small. All he's ever wanted to do is to grab you and to bring you to safety. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. May you come to appreciate and understand this amazing power of the gospel. And may I receive God's love and know that he sent his son into the world that I might live through him. Praise God for the gospel, the good news of salvation. Amen.